Well, first of all, thank you to the organizers for the invitation. I'm really glad to have the chance to present this material here. So I'll be lecturing about the Jones polynomial of a knot in three-dimensional space and a refinement of it that's known as Khovanov homology. So the first physics-based proposal was made by Gukov, Waffe, and Schwartz concerning Khovanov homology. They interpreted Khovanov homology in terms of vector spaces introduced a few years earlier by Ugri and Waffe. A number of years later, I reinterpreted this construction in terms of gauge theory and the counting of solutions of partial differential equations. I had two goals in doing this. One was to make the relationship with the description of the Jones polynomial in quantum field theory more transparent, and the other motivation was to make the whole subject more accessible to mathematicians. So that's the story I'll be describing today. Now, I've given a number of previous lectures on this that have been written up. What I'll explain is closest to the first half of the most recent one. If you are interested in reading the lectures you can find on the web, I recommend starting with the more recent ones and working backwards in time, as far as you have patience for. So in any event, the goal is to construct invariants of a knot in ordinary three-dimensional space. In the simplest version, we'll construct invariants of a knot in three-dimensional space by simply counting with signs the solutions of a differential equation, a partial differential equation. The solutions will have an integer value topological invariant that I'll call p. And if an is the signed number of solutions, where p is equal to n, then the Jones polynomial of the knot will be the sum of an times q to the n. An is supposed to vanish except for finitely many n, so this is supposed to be a Laurent polynomial. To get Khovanov homology, the situation is supposed to be categorified. That means that for each n, we want to define a complex of vector space whose Euler characteristic is a sub n. Now, categorifying the counting of solutions of an equation is possible if, and as far as I know, only if, the equation whose solutions we're counting is the equation for critical points of some Morse function. And here, this will be a Morse function in infinite dimensions, because the equation we're studying is already a partial differential equation. But we'll put this aside for a moment and assume we're just trying to describe the Jones polynomial. But the answer we'll arrive at will be one where the equations we're counting are equations for a critical point of something, so categorification will be possible. And the method by which it's possible will be familiar to anyone who's worked on subjects such as Floer theory in two or four dimensions, and therefore fits into this workshop, presumably. Now, the equation whose solutions we're supposed to count to get the Jones polynomial in Khovanov homology might look a little bit ad hoc if written down without an explanation of where they came from. So I could have started today's lecture by explaining the physical setup. So if you want to read that, you should read my lectures on the web, starting with the older ones, not the more recent ones. But not everyone would find this helpful, I imagine. So today, I'll have a different approach. I'll try to motivate the equations by starting with something that you might know, an established mathematical approach to Khovanov homology, namely symplectic Khovanov homology. And starting with symplectic Khovanov homology, we'll motivate introducing some differential equations in higher dimensions, 3, 4, and ultimately 5 dimensions, that'll be related to the Jones polynomial and Khovanov homology. Now, going all the way back to the original work of von Jones at the beginning, okay, read carefully, because you're arriving at the last minute where the lecture might make sense. So we're kind of taking a fresh start from this moment. So going all the way back to the original work of von Jones in 1983, most approaches to the Jones polynomial of a knot in three space define an invariant in terms of some sort of presentation of a knot. For example, a projection to a plane, which you could think of as the plane of the screen onto which that knot has been projected. One defines something that's manifestly well-defined once a presentation is given, what one defines is not obviously independent of the presentation, but turns out to be. And that step is where the magic is. You show that whatever weird thing you've defined miraculously obeys the rightmost relations. There is always some magic in approaches to the Jones polynomial and Khovanov homology that involve starting with some kind of presentation of a knot. An approach based on counting solutions of PDEs has the opposite advantages and drawbacks. Topological invariance is potentially manifest. Giving generalities about elliptic PDEs and assuming compactness is under control, but it may not be clear how to calculate. The ideal is to have manifest three, or in the categorified case, four-dimensional symmetry together with a method of calculation. How might you achieve this? Well, supposing you do know some PDEs which you believe are related to the Jones polynomial or Khovanov homology, how would you try to find a method of calculation? So adapting what's been done mathematically in many problems, I think the original version was by Attia and Floer in connection with Floer homology of a three-manifold. A natural try, which I followed in work with Gaiotto, is to stretch a knot in one direction. So we had exactly this problem, because in previous work, I discussed what the differential equations should be, and then we were looking for a method to calculate. So a natural thing to do is to stretch a knot in one direction. So this is, again, a knot presented in terms of a projection to a plane, but now we've stretched it for a long way in one direction, which I'll call the u direction, and then somehow the knot consists of a lot of parallel strands that go on for a long distance in u, and then it somehow terminates at the two ends. So you want it to be the case that, except near the ends, these solutions are independent of u. That's not automatically true, and Gaiotto and I actually found that it wasn't true for the simplest version of the equations. We had to make a perturbation to a slightly more generic situation to get a situation in which this would be true, or at least in a situation in which we could argue with a precision that physicists found convincing that it would be true. Then we define a moduli space M of U-independent solutions. So these are solutions now in two dimensions. So you can think of these as the solutions in the presence of infinite long strands that extend in the U direction. Now, in M, we define two subspaces, L sub L and L sub R, consisting of solutions that extend over the left or the right. I put the word subspaces in quotes because we don't really need to assume that a given solution extends in at most one way, but it's easier. The terminology is easier if we assume that. So I'll suppose that each solution extends in at most one way over the left or the right, and then I have subspaces of the moduli space consisting of solutions that extend. For example, a point in L sub L represents a solution in a semi-infinite situation with strands that are infinite on the right, but they somehow terminate on the left. So we hope it's the case that solutions in the semi-infinite case are simply solutions that are independent of U, but a subspace consisting of those that extend over the left. And then similarly, L sub R parameterizes solutions that extend over the right end. I'm not sure how to make this understandable when you've just walked in, but I'll say very briefly. We imagine we're studying some partial differential equations in the presence of a knot. We imagine stretching the knot in one dimension, and we hope that in the stretch situation, the solutions reduce to two-dimensional solutions. And then we further hope that for a semi-infinite solution, for a semi-infinite situation, we get a subspace of two-dimensional solutions that extend over the left. So L sub L is supposed to consist of solutions in bulk that extend over the left, and L sub R parameterizes solutions that extend over the right. And then for a global knot that terminates at both ends, the global solutions are supposed to be solutions in the middle that extend over both ends. So the global solutions are intersection points of L sub L and L sub R. And the integer an that appears as a coefficient in the Jones polynomial is supposed to be the algebraic intersection number of the two subspaces. Well, to be more exact, a solution has an integer invariant p, and a sub n is the algebraic intersection number where you only count intersections with p equals n. Yes? It could have been a link. I mean, the theory works fine for links as well as knots. Did I actually get a link here? OK. Well, that makes the point that links are fine. In the language of intersections, categorification can happen in a situation that anyone who has worked on Floer theory will be familiar with. So M, the moduli space of the solutions for long strands, should be a symplectic manifold. And the Ls should be Lagrangian submanifolds. And then the counting of intersection points has a categorification that's known as Floer cohomology, the A model or the Foucault category of M, that gives a framework for categorification. Now, in today's lecture, the reason that all these facts will be true is that even before we stretch the knots to reduce to intersections in M, the equations whose solution we're counting are equations for critical points of some Morse function. So we'll be in the situation Floer started with in his work back in the 80s in 3 plus 1 and also 1 plus 1 dimensions. Now, actually, any more questions before I go on? So in symplectic Khovanov homology, a version of this story is developed for Khovanov homology, at least in a singly graded version, with a very specific M. So I'll give a description of this M that was proposed by Chemnitzer and exploited in a mirror version by Kaldas and Chemnitzer. And it was an important clue in my work. It's as follows. M can be understood as a space of Hecke modifications. So let me explain what is a Hecke modification. So we start with the Riemann surface C, and we pick some compact Lie group G. So in we will be doing gauge theory after a while. So I reserve the letter G for a compact Lie group. And when I talk about its complexification, I call it G sub C. So G sub C is a complex Lie group that ultimately will be the complexification of the gauge group. And E will be a holomorphic G sub C bundle over C. Well, a Hecke modification of E at a point P is another holomorphic GC bundle E prime over C together with an isomorphism to E away from P. So phi is an isomorphism between E and E prime restricted to the complement of P. For example, suppose that the gauge group was U1 so that its complexification is C star. Then you can think of E as a holomorphic line bundle. And what would be another holomorphic line bundle, L prime, that's isomorphic to L away from P? Well, L prime would be L twisted by allowing a pole of degree n or maybe requiring a zero of degree n at P. So L prime, in this case, would be completely determined by an integer n and would be L tensored with O of P to the n. Now here, the integer n can be thought of as a weight of the Langlands or GNO dual group of C star, which in this case is another copy of C star. So in general, Hecke modifications occur in types that are labeled by weights of a group, which is known as the dual group. And this is the Langlands GNO dual group that was introduced in the 70s. The dual group of C star is another copy of C star. A weight of C star is an integer. And it's the integer that appears in this expression. Now, in general, for any semi-simple group G, there is a corresponding Langlands GNO dual group G dual with complexification G dual sub C, such that Hecke modifications of a holomorphic bundle at a point P and C occur in families that are classified by dominant weights or equivalently by finite dimensional representations of the dual group. And here it doesn't matter if we talk about the compact or the complex form of the dual group, since their finite dimensional representations are the same. I'll give one more example. Suppose that we start with a complex group which is GL2C, meaning that the underlying compact gauge group was U2. Well, then a GC bundle is a rank 2 complex vector bundle, holomorphic vector bundle, E over C. The Langlands dual group is again GL2C. And Hecke modifications now will be dual to representations of the dual group. So the dual group has an interesting two-dimensional representation. And let's describe the Hecke modifications dual to that. So a Hecke modification dual to the two-dimensional representation of the dual group is as follows. Pick some local decomposition of a rank 2 bundle E as O plus O in a neighborhood of P. And then E prime will be O of P plus O. So you twist by replacing O of P. You twist by allowing a pole in P, but only in a specified rank 1 subbundle. So the difference from the abelian case is that there's not just one Hecke modification of this type at P, but whole family, arising from the choice of decomposition of E as O plus O. Or more exactly, arising from the choice of a sumand O. We don't need the full decomposition, but we need the sumand in which we allow the pole. So because of the dependence on the decomposition, or more accurately, the choice of a subbundle that's replaced by O of P, the Hecke modifications of this type at P form a family parameterized by CP1.
Can you say why do representations of the dual group come into this? I can't see it.
Well, you're not going to see it quickly. And you see, what is the dual group? So there's a story of what the dual group is due to Langlands. And there's another story of what the dual group is to physicists Goddard, Noitz, and Olive from the from about 1974. And that second story led to a whole quantum field theory story with Hooft operators and duality between electric and magnetic charges. And then Kapustin and I, when we worked on geometric Langlands and gauge theory, interpreted it in this language. We made the bridge between the physics and the math pictures. So meanwhile, mathematicians in geometric Langlands had gone from whatever Langlands had to a geometric picture that involved Hecke modifications. There's a vast, vast story involved in the answer to your question. A proper explanation is not just another lecture, but a whole series of lectures. However, I will say a few words later. Maybe I'll come back to it later, because it'll be easier to at least say a few words when I tell you a little bit more about the Bogomolny equations. But there's a vast, vast story involved in your question. I think I better resist the temptation to say any more right now. But if anyone wants to volunteer to say no more than two sentences, I invite you. So in any case, in contrast to the case of C star, where a Hecke modification of a given type was unique, here the Hecke modifications of the type I indicated form a family parameterized by CP1. Because in the fiber at P, we had to pick a one-dimensional subspace where a pole is allowed. And the choice of a one-dimensional subspace of a two-dimensional vector space is parameterized by CP1. Now suppose we're given two endpoints at which we're going to make Hecke modifications of this type. And for simplicity, suppose that the Riemann surface is just the complex plane, or R2, except sometimes we'll add a point at infinity. So it'll be the complex plane, or else CP1. And we want to make Hecke modifications of this type of a trivial rank 2 bundle over C. So I've drawn the case that we've picked 6 points in C. So the space of all such Hecke modifications would be a copy of CP1 to the 2n, with one copy of CP1 at each point. However, there is a natural subvariety in CP1 to the 2n that's defined as follows. First of all, since our bundle was trivial to start with, and even after the Hecke modification, it was trivial near infinity, because it was trivial away from the points where we made the modification, it naturally compactifies over the point infinity, so we could be talking about bundles on CP1. So now we're making Hecke modifications of a trivial bundle over CP1. And each modification increased the degree by 1. So now we're going to get a bundle of degree 2n. And m is defined by saying that if we twist so that the degree is 0 again, the bundle should be trivial. So that'll be true generically, because a generic bundle over CP1 of degree 0 is trivial. But it won't always be true. We'll be throwing away a divisor where it is not true. So m is the complement of a divisor in CP1 to the 2n. Now, symplectic Khovanov homology is constructed by considering intersections of Lagrangian submanifolds in the space I just described. So I should say that when you throw away the divisor we're throwing away is a canonical divisor, and when we throw it away, we get a complex symplectic and even hyperkähler manifold. And symplectic Khovanov homology involves Lagrangian intersections in this complex symplectic manifold.
Does this involve some cyclic ordering of the endpoints? Or?
What did you say?
Does this involve a cyclic ordering of the endpoints?
No. We just picked, it's an unordered set of endpoints, because the statement, make a Hecke modification at a given type at each of these points, doesn't involve any ordering of those points. It was simply a collection of endpoints. So for every collection of endpoints, this is a complex, well, actually hyperkähler, but in particular, a complex symplectic manifold. And I'll give a description of it later that is manifestly hyperkähler. Now, we want to reinterpret this space in terms of partial differential equations of gauge theory. Because remember, what this space is supposed to be is what we get from some set of PDEs if we stretch in one direction. So we have to describe it in terms of gauge theory PDEs. And then we'll work our way back and get to gauge theory PDEs for the unstretched problem. So in my work with Kapustin on gauge theory and geometric Langlands, an important fact was that this M is a moduli space of solutions of a certain set of elliptic PDEs. But although M is defined in terms of bundles on a 2-manifold, the PDEs are in 3 dimensions on R3. As a result, everything in the rest of the lecture will be in a dimension 1 more than you might expect. So the Jones polynomial is an invariant of knots in 3 space. We'll get it by counting solutions of some PDEs in 4 dimensions. And for the categorified version, we will need PDEs in 5 dimensions. So the 3-dimensional PDEs that we need are known as the Bogomolny equations. They're equations for a pair A and phi, where A is a connection on a G bundle over a 3-manifold. W3 is an oriented 3-dimensional Riemannian manifold. Phi is a section of the corresponding adjoint bundle. Physicists would call phi an adjoint-valued scalar, or for compromise, we could call it an adjoint-valued zero form. If F is the curvature of A, then the Bogomolny equations are like so, where star is the Hodge star and d sub a is the gauge covariant extension of the exterior derivative. So these are elliptic differential equations modulo the gauge group. Their solutions are called monopoles. They were studied by Bogomolny and other physicists starting in the 70s in that connection. And for example, Nam and later Atiyah and Hitchin and Kronheimer and many other physicists and mathematicians, Eric Weinberg, I shouldn't have started giving a list of names because it would be impossible to do that fairly. But many, many people have studied these equations as equations for monopoles. These equations have many remarkable properties explored by the physicists and mathematicians who I either remembered or didn't remember to state a moment ago. And we'll just concentrate on one aspect. We'll consider the Bogomolny equations on a 3-manifold that happens to be R times C, where C is a Riemann surface. Actually, in our application, C will just be the complex plane. But for a while, C could be any, or CP1 maybe, either of the two. But for a while, we could use any Riemann surface. Any connection A on a G bundle over a Riemann surface determines a holomorphic structure on the bundle, or more exactly, on its complexification. You just write the covariant derivative as a sum of terms of type 0, 1, and 1, 0, and you use the 0, 1 part to define the complex structure. Since we're in one complex dimension, there's no integrability condition, and this defines a holomorphic bundle. So for any y in R, even without the Bogomolny equations, If you take any bundle with connection over 3 manifold R times C, and you restrict it to Y times C for any Y, you get a holomorphic bundle E sub Y over C. So in general, we would always get a one real parameter family of holomorphic bundles. But if the Bogle-Monney equations are satisfied, E sub Y is canonically independent of Y. Indeed, a consequence of the Bogle-Monney equations is that D bar A is independent of Y. This is a misprint. It should be Y rather than R, up to conjugation. If we parameterize R by Y, then part of the Bogle-Monney equations say this, showing that up to conjugation, the D bar operator is canonically independent of Y, and thus there's a canonical isomorphism between the EYs of different Y. Incidentally, the same specialization of the Bogle-Monney equations, read in a different way, was used by Donaldson, I think more than 30 years ago, where he reinterpreted the Bogle-Monney equations in terms of holomorphic maps, in terms of spaces of rational functions. So the statement that E sub Y is independent of Y is a kind of dual version of what Donaldson said. Now, the Bogle-Monney equations admit solutions with a singularity at an isolated point in R3, or in a more general 3-manifold. So these singularities, for example, were used by Hooft in the 70s, and they have an older history going back to Dirac. And they were first studied mathematically, I think, by Kronheimer in the 80s. I'll first describe the picture for U1. We fix an integer n, and we observe that the Bogle-Monney equation has an exact solution for any point in R3. I've just written down the solution. The denominator is simply the absolute value of the distance of a point, the distance between a point x and some base point x0. I've only defined f and not the connection A whose curvature is f, or the line bundle L in which A is a connection. But such an L and A exist and are essentially unique if n is an integer. So this is the Dirac monopole solution, Dirac monopole, physicists call it. Well, except that Dirac didn't really have phi. Dirac had the gauge theory part of this solution as a singular solution of Maxwell's equations. Now, if G is U1, then since the Bogle-Monney equations are linear, they have a unique solution with singularities labeled by specified integers at specified points in R3. The solution is literally just a linear combination of what I wrote before. But I want to assume that the sum of the n's is 0, which ensures that the given solution vanishes at infinity faster than 1 over x. I'll explain in a moment why I want that condition. Now, all this was completely invariant. It just was a statement about R3. But to go on, we take a decomposition of R3 as R times R2, where we identify R2 as the complex plane. We suppose the singularities are at points yi times pi. Yi is in R, pi is in C. As long as y is not one of the bad points, the indicated solution of the Bogle-Monney equation determines a holomorphic line bundle L sub y over C. And this naturally extends over CP1 because the solution vanishes at infinity faster than 1 over x. That's why I took the sum of the n's to be 0. It was so I had a natural extension over CP1. Ly is constant up to isomorphism if y is not one of the bad points. But even when you jump across one of the bad points, nothing would happen if you throw away the point pi in CP1. Because the Bogle-Monney equations, even at the bad value of y, are obeyed except for one bad point pi in C. So think of y running this way, and this is the complex plane. Even at a bad value of y where we run into a bad point, only one point in C is bad. So if you throw away one bad point in C, the Bogle-Monney equations would still be obeyed. And that means that Ly is canonically constant, independent of y, even going across a bad point in y, as long as you throw away one bad point in CP1. So that means that in crossing y equals yi, L sub y undergoes a Hecke modification. And the integer in the Hecke modification will just be the integer in the solution of the Bogle-Monney equations. That follows from topological considerations involving the first Schrödinger class. Now again, because the sum of the n's is zero, L sub y is canonically trivial as y goes to plus or minus infinity. So we've described a we have a solution of the PDE, and it describes a sequence of Hecking modifications from a trivial bundle over CP1 to itself. We can do something similar for any simple E group G. And the construction is important in physical applications of quantum field theory. And when I was asked what it had to do with the dual group, well, for physicists that started with the work of Gno and at Hooft, but what they were doing was saying that the dual of electric charge was this kind of singularity which we'll be talking about in the Bogomolny, well, it's more general than the Bogomolny equations, but in particular in the Bogomolny equations. So to generalize what I said to any simple E group G, we let T be a maximal torus of G with abelian Lie algebra, little t. We pick a homomorphism from U1 to little t. Up to a Weyl transformation, such a homomorphism is equivalent to a dominant weight of the dual group, so it corresponds to a representation of the dual group. What I've just said is kind of a starting point in mathematical explanations of what the dual group is. I think you'd sometimes run into this definition or characterization of the dual group. We turn the singular solution of the U1 Bogomolny equations that we already used, well, the n equals 1 case of it. So A and phi are the n equals 1 solution for U1. Well, we map, but now we have a map from U1 to T, and T is a subalgebra of G, of the Lie algebra of G. So just via rho, we map the U1 singular solution to any G. So without further ado, for every representation of the dual group, we have a singularity in the Bogomolny equations for G. Then we look for solutions of the Bogomolny equations for G with singularities of this type. So the singularity up to gauge transformation should be the one I just described. It should have the same singular behavior that this has at specified points in R3. So the picture is the same as before, except now the points are labeled not by simple integers, but by homomorphisms from U1 to the maximal torus, or in other words, by representations of the dual group. The relation is just that in the abelian case, an integer defines a representation of the dual group. Also, now we have to specify that the solution should go to zero faster than infinity than 1 over r. In the abelian case, if I say that the sum of the n's is zero, that's automatically true. So it's a condition on the representations. But in the non-abelian case, this is a condition on the solutions, not a condition on the representations. We have to say that that's the kind of solution we want. Given this, a solution describes a sequence of Hecking modifications of type rho I at pi, mapping a trivial G bundle over CP1 to itself. So the G bundle over CP1 is there because the solution vanishing at infinity faster than 1 over r gives a natural compactification from C to CP1, and the solution is the bundle is trivial in the far left or the far right for the same reason, because the solution vanishes at infinity faster than 1 over r. Now, the moduli space M of these solutions with the indicated singularities vanishing at infinity faster than 1 over r is actually a hypercalor manifold, especially first studied by Kronheimer in the 1980s from a mathematical point of view. If we pick a decomposition of R3 as R times R2 that picks one of the complex structures on this hypercalor manifold, and we get the moduli space of Hecking modifications of the indicated types, mapping a trivial bundle over CP1 to itself. And this is now a complex symplectic manifold. It has a hypercalor structure that involves additional information, and that additional information depends on where the points are in this direction. But if you only care about it as a complex symplectic manifold, you can forget that coordinate and just remember the other two coordinates, And then you get the space which is used in symplectic Khovanov homology. So we've reinterpreted the space that's used in symplectic Khovanov homology as a space of solutions of PDEs in three dimensions. Now, this can be used to account for a number of properties of spaces of Hecking modifications. But for today, we want to focus on the fact that for knot theory, we want M to be a space of U-independent solutions of some equations. And that's not what we got. We got M as a space of solutions of some equations, but there wasn't any variable that the solutions didn't depend on, not yet. So we've described M as solutions of some PDEs on R3. So now we have to think of M as a space of U-independent solutions on R4, which will be R3 times R, where the second factor is parameterized by U. So we need the following fact, which would not certainly be true for a generic set of elliptic PDEs. We want our PDEs in three dimensions to simply describe the U-independent solutions of some elliptic PDEs in four dimensions. There actually are natural PDEs in four dimensions at work, sometimes called the KW equations. They appeared in my work, again, with Kapustin on geometric Langlands. They're equations for pair A and phi, where A is a connection now on a G bundle over a 4 manifold, and phi is now a 1 form valued in the adjoint bundle. So you can write the equations almost the same. Well, in three dimensions, we didn't need this term, this equation, and we didn't need this term. So they look a lot like the Bogomolny equations, but they're a little bit longer because we're in four dimensions instead of three, and phi is a 1 form instead of a 0 form. In the special case that y4 is w3 times r, a is a pullback from w3, and phi is a 0 form times du, where u parameterizes the second factor in y4. These equations reduce to the Bogomolny equations. So the same codimension 3 singularity we had in the Bogomolny equations, we can now pull it back. We can interpret it as a solution of this kind of the four-dimensional equations. So now, in that language, we have a four-dimensional elliptic PDE but this four-dimensional elliptic PDE, our special solution, now has a singularity along a line instead of a point. So the singular solution of the Bogomolny equations that we already studied can be regarded as a singular solution of the KW equation, but now with a singularity along a line rather than a point. So if y4 is a 4 manifold, S in y4 is an embedded 1 manifold, we label it by a homomorphism from U1 to T or by a representation of the dual group, you can look for solutions of the KW equations with a singularity of the indicated type along S. This is a well-behaved elliptic problem, and under appropriate conditions, it's reasonable to expect to prove as a mathematician some compactness properties and show that the counting makes sense. If you specialize to the case that y4 is a product and S is a union of possibly of circles, and the circles, of one manifolds, the one manifolds live at points in W3 times R. So in other words, I want Y4 to be the product of W3 times a one manifold, and I simply want S to be a bunch of copies of that one manifold at different points in Y. So if we specialize to this situation where it makes sense to say that the solution is U independent, then you can show that U independent solutions of the KW equations that have a reasonable behavior at infinity are parameterized by M. This is a mixture of two statements. The first statement is that U-independent solutions of the KW equations that vanish faster than 1 over R at infinity simply are parameterized by M because the KW equations simply reduce to the Bogomolny equations. The second, more subtle statement is that you can show that these are all solutions of the KW equations in this situation that are reasonable at infinity. So we have an elliptic PD in four dimensions, and we can specify in an interesting way what kind of singularity it should have on an embedded circle on Y4. And if we stretch, its solutions are related to what's studied in symplectic Khovanov homology. But there's something that might have crossed your minds already. This is a ridiculous framework for knot theory, because there's no notion of knottedness of one manifold in a four manifold. So we've done a lot of work to arrive at nothing. Well, obviously, a couple of things are missing from what I've said so far. So there are a few directions we could go next. But so there are two directions to go in, because there are two things that have to be explained. So one direction would take us most quickly to the categorified theory, but only for the simply graded theory. The second direction would take us to the Q grading and the Jones polynomial. So there isn't really time to do both of them today. So I'm going to head for categorification, which will resolve the point I just mentioned, that we didn't have a sensible framework for knot theory because there's no knottedness of one manifold in a four manifold. Then I'll give a few hints about what one would have to do to complete the story with the Q grading and make contact with the Jones polynomial. But there won't be time for a full explanation. So we'll have to now change gears for a moment and go back to the question of categorification, resuming a theme that I touched on briefly at the beginning. We'll practice with an ordinary equation rather than a partial differential equation. Suppose we're on a finite dimensional compact oriented manifold N with a real vector bundle V in an equidimensional case. Suppose we're also given a section S and that everything is properly oriented. Then we can define an integer by counting with multiplicities, in particular with signs, the zeros of S. And that integer is the Euler class of the vector bundle. Now, in general, if you're counting solutions of a PDE, that involves a generalization of this picture to function spaces. But we want to categorify. In general, as far as I know, you can't categorify the Euler class of a vector bundle. But suppose the vector bundle is the cotangent bundle, and the section is the differential of a Morse function. Then the zeros of S, which are critical points of H, have a natural categorification described in Morse homology. You define a complex V with a basis vector psi sub p for every critical point p of H. This complex is z-graded by assigning to psi sub p the index of the critical points, which is just the number of negative directions of the Hessian matrix of second derivatives of the Morse function. And it has a natural differential that, if you work in Floer theory, you'll be familiar with, that's defined by counting gradient flow lines between different critical points. So concretely, you define the differential by counting in a familiar way the one-parameter families of flows from P to Q. So a flow is a solution of a gradient flow equation. So if you have a problem of counting solutions of a PDE and you want to categorify it, you should try to put yourself in this situation. So that tells us what we need to do in order to be able to categorify a problem of counting solutions of the KW equations. We have to be able to write these equations as equations for a critical point of some functional gamma of A and phi. Well, physicists call it a functional because it depends on functions. You might just call it a function on an infinite dimensional function space. So the KW equations should the Euler-Lagrange equations for some functional gamma of A and phi. If so, you formally would have a framework for categorification. You'd have to worry about issues of compactness and so on. If so, you've only gotten past the first hurdle. The second hurdle is that the associated gradient flow equation, which will be a partial differential equation in five dimensions on R times Y4, has to be elliptic, so it makes sense to try to count its solutions. So a generic gamma won't be any good. Only special gammas work. For example, just for fun, you could take the gamma, which is the Lagrangian of the standard model of particle physics. That's a gamma that would occur to physicists. Then you could write down this five-dimensional equation. Well, it'll be a parabolic equation, not an elliptic equation. And parabolic equations have their uses, but they're not very good if you want to count solutions. So you need a very special gamma if this is going to work. Somewhat analogously to the fact that when we went to 3 to 4 dimensions, we just had to shut our eyes and hope that there was a four-dimensional PDE whose U-independent solutions would give the Bogomolny equations. We're shutting our eyes and hoping for the best once again. Well, generically, what we want is not true. It's not true that the KW equations on a generic four manifold Y4 are equations for a critical point of anything. But this is true if Y4 is W3 times R for some W3. If singularities are present on an embedded one manifold in Y4, then there is a further condition. And this further condition is crucial, so read the sentence carefully. The KW equations in this situation are equations for critical points of a functional if and only if S is contained in a three manifold W3 times a point. Q is a point in R. So for categorification to be possible, S has to actually be embedded in a three manifold, not just in a four manifold. That's why we can get non-trivial knot theory. So what we were doing was ridiculous, except for this fact. So to make categorification possible, we have to be in the situation that leads to knot theory. S is an embedded one manifold in a three manifold. Naively, this leads to categorified knot invariance for any three manifold W3. But physically and mathematically, there are some subtleties about it. I'm not completely sure what the situation will be ultimately. But mathematically, you have to worry about compactness properties, which have been most investigated by Taubes, I might say, but without considering the singularities one wants. When one investigates compactness properties, one runs into the Ricci tensor. And it might be we need the Ricci tensor to be non-negative, a very restrictive condition. On the physics side, there also are some subtleties, which I won't try to discuss now. Now, what I've described so far is supposed to correspond if the three manifold is just R3. The group is PGL2, which is the same as SO3. Well, unfortunately, I clashed with my previous notation. SO3 is a real form of PGL2, but since I write G for the gauge group, I should have written here SO3. And then rho should correspond to the two-dimensional representation of the dual group, for which I should have written SU2. Anyway, for SO3 and the two-dimensional representation of the dual group, the claim is that we get here a singly graded Khovanov homology in its original version. The reason it's only singly graded is that the only grading I've mentioned is the one that's associated to the Morse index, or in other words, to categorification. In the mathematical theory, you say that singly graded Khovanov homology becomes trivial if you decategorify it and forget the Q grading. In other words, the completely ungraded Khovanov homology is trivial, uninteresting. So in my framework, the completely ungraded theory corresponds to counting the solutions where S was simply an embedded one manifold in a four manifold. And the statement that singly graded Khovanov homology becomes trivial if uncategorified corresponds to what we had about 10 minutes ago, where before we learned how to categorify, what we had was uninteresting because there is no knottedness for a circle, embedded circle in a four manifold. So I'd like to, at least very briefly, explain where the second grading of Khovanov homology comes from. And that second grading is the one that survives in the decompactified theory and leads to the Jones polynomial. I said decompactified. The second grading is the one that is non-trivial in the decategorified theory, or uncategorified, and gives the Jones polynomial. The Q grading is supposed to come from the second Chern class integrated over the four-manifold Y4. Well, second Chern class is terminology for the unitary group. But in general, for any simple Lie group, there's a four-dimensional cohomology class analogous to the second Chern class. I really don't know a general name for it, so I'm just calling it the second Chern class. But there's an integer-valued invariant when we're doing... Sorry. No, thanks. There's an integer-valued invariant when, in general, when we do gauge theory on a four-manifold, and that's supposed to give the Q grading. But for topological reasons, it can't be defined in the construction as I've presented it so far. You see, the second Chern class is defined for a bundle over a compact four-manifold. If it's not compact, you need some conditions on what's happening at infinity. In our case, even if Y is compact, we're allowing a singularity along S. And topologically, in the presence of this kind of singularity, there simply is no integer invariant corresponding to the second Chern class. So that's why, in the story as I've presented it so far, there is no Q grading. There's only a cohomological grading. And the decategorified theory is trivial or uninteresting. The physical picture tells us what we have to do to get the Q grading. Our four-manifold should be a manifold with boundary, and the knot should be placed in its boundary. So I'm drawing the uncategorified picture. So in the categorified picture, there's a fifth dimension. So we'll do something on this four-manifold with boundary. That something will involve critical points of some functional. So then you can introduce a categorified version with a fifth dimension. But we're stepping back now and explaining the uncategorified picture where we want to get the Q grading. For that, we're supposed to let our four-manifold be a manifold with boundary and place the knot in the boundary. The boundary condition is a subtle one. Unfortunately, I didn't update this from a previous workshop where Rafe Mazio gave a lecture on the boundary condition. And we don't really have time to describe the boundary condition. But the boundary condition is a very subtle one. Rafe and I wrote a paper describing this boundary condition away from a knot, and because it's subtle even away from knots. And we're writing a second paper describing mathematically the boundary condition near a knot. But among other things, the boundary condition has the property that the bundle is trivialized on the boundary. So now the second Chern class can be defined. Well, it can be defined if Y4 is compact or if the gauge connection is constrained at infinity, for example, if it vanishes at infinity. So at any rate, the boundary condition is such that the knot does not present any obstacle to defining the second Chern class. So to get the Q grading, you run the whole story I've told you on a four-manifold with boundary, but with the boundary condition that's rather long to explain. So in work I mentioned at the beginning, Gaiotto and I analyzed this situation. In the uncategorified situation, so we were counting solutions in four dimensions, not five, aiming to show directly, without the physical picture, that the Jones polynomial is the counting function for these solutions. As usual, the starting point was to stretch the knot in one direction to reduce the solutions in one dimension less. So I've drawn a stretched knot, but now it's stretched along the boundary of a four-manifold. The solutions in one dimension less that satisfy the boundary condition turn out to be related to a lot of interesting mathematical physics involving integrable systems, geometric Langlands, the beta-ansatz, O-pairs, and all kinds of other things. So just this part of the story would certainly merit another lecture, which I can't give now. But we arrived at a description of the Jones polynomial that was new to us, but which, as we now understand, is that of Bigelow, following earlier work by Ruth Lawrence. So that's the best answer one has now for explaining, without any reference to the physical picture, why one would claim that the function you get this way actually is the Jones polynomial. What we added to what was known previously was to derive this description from a starting point with manifest three-dimensional symmetry. And that last sentence also refers to another workshop where I was giving two lectures. Thank you. There's not a sequence. No, no. Well, a local picture along one knot. The local picture is in codimension. Well, yeah, it's really in codimension 3. But at the end of the lecture, the knot's in the boundary, so which is simulating codimension 2. If you're comfortable thinking of a knot as being in codimension 3, the local picture is a codimension 3 singularity, which is given by just embedding in G, well, in a maximal torus inside G, an abelian solution. There's a solution for U1. You embed it in any G. That gives a local codimension 3 singularity for that G. Each knot is labeled by the representation of the dual group. So in the three dimensions, in the singly graded version, where you don't worry about the boundary, in the singly, which is the only version I explained in detail in the lecture, in the three dimensions normal to the knot, you see that codimension 3 singularity. And that's an elliptic singularity. In other words, the 3, 4, and 5 dimensional equations in the presence of that singularity are all elliptic in an appropriate sense. So the counting of solutions makes sense. Is that satisfactory?
And then the Hecke modifications would come from slicing in any...
Well, Hecke modifications are an interpretation. Hecke modifications are interpretation, so... First, you have to stretch the knot in one dimension, so you maybe see many strands. As I've drawn it, I mean, well... Okay, it's a little hard to picture because there are three dimensions normal to this. So. That picture is happening in a product of the complex plane times R. So if you project onto the complex plane, you simply see a lot of Hecke modifications at prescribed points.
Because this my question was whether the R direction inside that three-dimensional thing is fixed, or can it be any arbitrary chosen direction?
When we're discussing the Bolgomoni equations, it's any arbitrary direction.
And in your setup, is it still arbitrary, or does it have to point?
Well. So in four dimensions, my equations, the KW equations, have four-dimensional symmetry. So there are no preferred directions. So preferred directions only arise in... I could have saved time by not giving any motivation. I could have said, physicists, starting with some crazy considerations in string theory or quantum field theory or something that most mathematicians working in this workshop would not try to understand, claim that these are the right equations to study. It would have been much quicker. Not only would it have been much quicker, but I've given lectures about that like that in the past. You might find, you can look on the web and see my previous lectures. The first one might seem a little bit like that. But maybe the written version isn't quite like that. I'm not sure. You could form your own opinion. I was trying to motivate it. I tried to motivate it by starting with something that at least some of you know about already, and it's at least relatively close to the interests of many in this room, which was symplectic Khovanov homology, where Khovanov homology was interpreted in Floer theory. To make contact between this picture and that one involves stretching a knot. The stretching introduces a preferred direction. So I began the lecture, in a sense, from a picture where there was a preferred direction chosen. Then we worked backwards to what physicists would call a more natural covariant picture. Is that clear?
But basically, there's no second preferred direction.
There's no preferred, well, at the very end direction, and there's a boundary, so you could say the normal direction is preferred. But except in that sense, there's no preferred direction. So at the very end, the boundary in the categorified theory is a 4-manifold and a 5-manifold. And the 4-manifold is oriented, but has no additional structure. Yes. Well, The question is about the compactness properties. And mathematically, that's the big question that has to be addressed. And Taubes has written a series of papers on closely related equations. Some of his papers apply to some of these equations, and they're all closely related. Taubes has essentially investigated this in 3 and 4 dimensions, maybe not 5 yet, but without worrying about the singularities. So I think a slightly optimistic version. I'd like to say that the reason why am I giving a lecture that does not have more physics in it? It's because I actually believe that mathematicians can make this picture I'm telling you about rigorous if you take it seriously. I'm not certain what's the line of least resistance, but I find it plausible. Well, Rafe and I are trying to write a second paper on the boundary condition. I think it's quite plausible that maybe something like Taubes' work could be adapted in the presence of the boundary condition. And then possibly that would be a route to answering your questions about bubbling. I should have told you, though, the serious questions aren't about conventional bubbling, as in Donaldson theory. The serious question has to do with what happens if the one form phi tries to become large. I think that's the best answer for now. Let me think of something else I should tell you. Okay. If one gets as far as proving rigorously that the invariants are well-defined, I'll be quite curious then whether the approach I followed with Giotto would be regarded as a useful mathematical starting point for making contact rigorously with the Jones polynomial and eventually Khovanov homology. Where I should mention work recently by Greg Moore and a student. Unfortunately, the student's name is slipping my mind. Or whether there'll be completely different approaches that will seem better. But we'll see. Thank you.